the wait list, just to address your last point, the wait list to get into our clean and sober shelters runs between 5 and 6 months long. Those beds are filled every night, and the wait list is 5 or 6 months long. Simply put, the scale of the problem we're faced with, when people use that phrase, homelessness crisis, state of emergency around homelessness and affordable housing, that's not marketing. And as we heard earlier, it ain't just us. It's up and down the West Coast, from Vancouver, Canada, all the way down to San Diego. It is not pretty, but the scale of it demands all hands on deck. People from the faith community, local government, state government, defense. This is a time where we need all of those actors pulling together.
Good luck with the feds.
Good luck with the feds.
Okay, we'll take a question from this side, please. Hi, thank you for being here tonight. My name is Kara. I am a homeowner and resident in the Mount Scott neighborhood, and I'm very concerned about this shelter as well. There's no denying that there's a housing and homelessness crisis. However, my main concerns are the availability of resources for those who would be staying at this shelter. I understand that the shelter provides resources to these people, but outside of that shelter, we are losing the Fred Meyer Market due to crime and theft and not being properly patrolled and taken care of. And without that market, we will not be able to have a full-service grocery store within 2 miles for these residents to get food to provide for themselves. We do have some smaller markets, but they are much more costly. As well as that, I'm not aware of any food banks or meal service programs within the vicinity of the shelter. Or how far away are they? And in fact, so I have a couple questions for you regarding the shelter. And that is, when you allow people to stay and reserve a bed at the shelter, how long can they stay there for?
They can stay as long as they need to stay there, until they're able to move on to a better
shelter. Is that
weeks or
months?
Okay. So let me address your question and also try to address the previous question about queuing, because again, just to be really clear, this shelter will operate on a reservation system that involves a phone call or presenting yourself at the day center in Bud Clark College. Okay. And it's to avoid any queuing, any lining up to try to get into the shelter. Okay? And because it's open 24/7, there aren't lines. There's no mass exodus in the morning. There's no big return line waiting to get in the evening. It is a 24-hour facility where if you are staying there, you can leave your possessions there all day. If you have a pet, you're welcome to bring your pet inside as well. Okay? That's laundry facilities, toilets, showers, and access to social workers and case managers to help with things like wellness and like housing, especially. So, you can you repeat your question now? Length of stay. Length of stay varies because people's bounds of homelessness vary. What's important in a shelter like this is that people understand where they're going to be able to sleep tonight and tomorrow night. That they can be assured that they have a safe place to lay down their head, but also to lay down their possessions during the day. When we can provide that type of assurance to people, we find that those other services, those wraparound services that are so important to people who are living with homelessness, can take hold. There's something there for traction for those services. Whereas when you're not sure, you don't know where you're going to be sleeping tonight, it's very, very difficult for many folks sleeping outside to see the way forward.
Has the city finally been here?
When you say this neighborhood, are you talking about Foster Powell, Mount Scott, or are you talking about Southeast Portland? when you talk about the homeless population in this southeast Portland, which is quite a large quadrant. We are 5.6 miles from the city center. Okay. And then two more questions. Wondering the due diligence for choosing this location with regard to prime location. There's so many vacancies on Foster. I just don't understand how this is going to help build our community up. Policing, and then also wondering, Mayor Wheeler, what you are doing to work toward permanent housing for these people and affordability.
I'll be super quick. Number one, you passed a $256 million bond levy. The first project has just been announced on that. That will create about 1,300 units, half of which will be very low income, so 30% AMA or less. About half of that will be families, so that's working families with kids. In the city of Portland, I think the best thing I can actually do is get the permits that are currently in process vested to actual construction. The private sector creates far more housing than the public sector does, but we need to keep making sure that we improve that permitting process, reduce the time and cost and the hassle factor associated with it to get as many of those units vested as possible.
What about the 6,000 units that we need?
Okay, we're running out of time. We're going to allow Kenya's side to do one more question. And then, as a reminder, the staffers are staying behind to take more questions.
You know what? I find this argument that 22% of the homeless are in this neighborhood requiring this shelter, when that 22% is driven here by design, by the rest of the city, enforcing the watering laws on the west side and emptying out a trail and putting them here. And now you're saying that that engineering of these people being here is not requiring us to put in a very, very dangerous type of institution in our school.
I don't think so.
But I'll tell you, what? This is not about compassion. If it was compassion, you'd want to put an extra yard into your house. It's not about compassion. This is about putting this in a middle-class neighborhood where we can't defend ourselves, where we leave our houses every day, so that we cannot pay attention to our house when we're at work, we can't pay attention to our cars when we're at work. And the wealthy neighborhoods get nothing. You know that. The Northwest Heights, they don't get any, we don't send homeless over there. If 22% of homeless were living there, they wouldn't be living there very long. I see those big neighborhoods who are a vulnerable neighborhood. And that is the only real thing here. This is not about compassion. This is about victimization.
Thank you.
We'll take one more. Ms. Kenya, can we take it from this side? Okay.
I have experience in transitional housing.
I was only going to ask a question. I thought I heard Mayor Wheeler say, would you be interested if it was a higher barrier? And no one brought that up. So I just want to say, it's on
the table. All right, so the mayor is saying that it is an open question, so there'll be further discussion about that. Let's take one more question from over here.
If we were going to house families in crisis or women with their children, I think most of what you hear is really loud and angry. Is this coming from fear? Or we don't know what this is going to look like. Yeah.
We have people in nature.
Thank you, sir. One last question from Ms. Kenya's side, and then we're going to release our panel. And then their staff is in the back. One of the staffers is waving their hand. We have a couple of hands back there. So please address your further questions with the staff. Thank you.
First of all, thank you guys so much for coming and allowing us an opportunity to speak, both for and against. I'm a 20-plus year homeowner here. I first want to know what funds are actually earmarked to be available for this project. So we're talking earmarked so they can't go elsewhere. How long are they guaranteed? When do the policies sunset and the funds and resources become vulnerable? I think that's a very important fact that we need to know. And then also I want to speak to the fact that I have provided transitional housing in an ADU to a couple, and I rented it to them at well below market rate, and I just want to share my experience. Even with support, jobs, and insurance, within months, the 35-year-old gentleman was drinking and abusing prescription drugs again. There were emergency room visits. Eventually, they went missing. And then there was a call from a detective in the Southeast Spring Savings that I got while I was at work. And my daughter was at home alone. They had a warrant, and they wanted to bring in an interception team, which reads SWAT team, into my home to apprehend them. This happened on 63rd, right next to Schiller, which is a block and a half from your post site. The year before, the police had asked to use my backyard, which is two blocks away from the post site, to surveil a drug house where the residents were dealing meth. Foster Road has long been known as, in the full Foster-Powell corridor, lots of drug problems. We boast, kind of a per capita, the most bars, strip clubs, and cannabis shops in the city. And I just think if you're really here to help the vulnerable population get safe and sober, this is not the place to do it. And I want to thank you guys for your time.
Thank you very much. Thank you, members, for coming. To our panel, Mr. Mayor, commissioners, guests, thank you. There are advanced staffers in the back who are willing to continue the conversation.